Gordon was already a well-known public figure before he entered political life from 1987 to early 1990 as Minister of Trade, Enterprise and later Tourism. He served under the National Alliance for Reconstruction government for a period of just over 3 years. His entry into politics came about unexpectedly. Ken Gordon had already established himself through his progressive ideas and the role of the media and press freedom as a formidable watchdog. As he recounts in his autobiography, Getting It Right, Winning Caribbean Press Freedom, quote,
I received a telephone call one evening around 9 p.m. from the Prime Minister-elect, asking me to come and see him as soon as possible.
Mr. Robinson and I go back some way. We've had a long relationship, but it was always a personal relationship and not a political relationship. What we never did do was discuss any prospect of my involvement in politics if he got into office, because that just was never on the cards. When he invited me, it came as a total surprise. But I can tell you that insofar as why he invited me, I'm not going to second guess him. So I think you would have to ask him that question, because he would have his reasons, I suppose. Whether they were misguided or not, events subsequently would determine that.
Herbert Atwell, chairman of the National Alliance for Reconstruction Party, was present at the meeting when Mr. Gordon arrived at Mr. Robinson's home the next day.
I remember clearly, in December 1986, after the government won, after the NAR won the elections, I was asked by the then Prime Minister to contact Mr. Gordon, which I did. It was about 8:30 in the evening, and I phoned him and asked him if he would be kind enough to see the Prime Minister, who wanted to have a conversation with him. So he arrived at about 9 o'clock, impeccably dressed in his white trousers and white shoes. And after the usual pleasantries, the Prime Minister said to him that he wanted to get a recommendation from Mr. Gordon as to the person who could be made Minister of Industry. So Mr. Gordon did not know that he was under the microscope. So he proceeded to make 2 recommendations. And eventually the Prime Minister said to him, what about you? And I remember the look on his face. He was absolutely shocked. So he said that he had to travel to Jamaica the next morning, and he was pressed to give an answer. So he said he would go to the chairman of his board and get his view and come back, which he did. He then said that the chairman had agreed that he could accept the appointment, and he wanted some time to reflect and to talk to his family. But he would not go to Jamaica the morning, and he would come back. And it is in those circumstances that Mr. Gordon became the Minister of Industry and Enterprise.
Throughout his political career, Ken Gordon struggled fiercely to break barriers and to stake a claim for himself and for others to come. It appeared to be a defining feature of his character. Where did it come from?
Any job in which you're charged with a responsibility to point a direction has certain fundamentals about it. You've got to get as much information as you can. You've got to get the right people around you. And you've got to try and make yourself credible to the people with whom you work. Whatever that job is, those are some fundamentals that are unshakable. And if you go into a job in that way, you learn the job. You learn the essentials about the job. And you get the people around you who can guide you. After that, it's just a matter of making the decisions. So let's say 1, 2, 3. Those are the elements which I have always used into any new situation, and they worked for me. So that this was no exception.
By the time Ken Gordon came into public office, It was clear that he wanted to continue in the style of management that served him well and endeared him to those who worked closely with him. His people-centered approach as a businessman was not simply about profit and loss.
People are people wherever they are. And while some people may be working in a system which does not stimulate them, and therefore they're not being particularly productive, because the system doesn't lend itself to thinking aggressively. So they think safely, and they always ensure that they do anything to get them in trouble. So everything slows down. But if you can create a different environment, which I think we did, initially, of course, there was resistance, that is understandable. But the question is never how big the problem is, it's always how you deal with the problem, in my view. And therefore, I think we dealt with it in one particular instance. A report was made to me that somebody who had come in for a license and had been told he wouldn't get that license was told by the officer, if you don't like my decision, go up and see God upstairs. Huh? That was referring to me, of course. So that subsequently came back to me. And I called the person, who was a very senior person, and I said, look, I received a report that you dismissed this request for appeal by referring to me as God. If that didn't happen, forget this conversation never took place. But if it did happen, I want you to know that I give a lot of loyalty to my people. And I would expect the same kind of loyalty and not this kind of dismissive comments. And that chap turned out to be one of my staunchest allies by the time I left 3 years later. And that was so about the department. I found everybody in that department to be as conscious of achievement as I could have hoped after 3 years. It wasn't like that when I went in, but I suppose it's a matter of the environment you create.
I recall in his early days some of the difficulties he had, because one must remember that he came from being the boss of a big private sector company and had to make the transition to all of the things that go with being a government minister, the interaction with the public servants and so on. And he had some difficulty. But he never wanted really to be in politics, as it were. He was focused on getting a job done. He was focused on achieving objectives, and he always seemed to have a roadmap. And there are so many things one remembers. He's a man of almost unequaled determination when he has a point of view. And he always does. He has a point of view. And he's not unprepared to argue that point of view with anybody, whether you be prime minister or whoever. And that is the nature of the man.
Ken Gordon has maintained many of his interests in business, politics, people, and of course his champion cause, Caribbean integration.
It is difficult to fault the concept of CARICOM and the concept of Caribbean unity. The problem always comes around in implementation. I suspect that if you got hold of the agendas of the CARICOM heads of government meeting over the last 10 years, you would find very little change from the one they have now to the one they had 10 years ago. Why? And I think it's how it's conceived, how it's structured. Maybe it was necessary initially for some of the rules to apply, but the thing called the unanimity rule means that no decision can be taken and approved unless everybody approves it. Now getting 8, 9, then now 13 or whatever number of countries you have, and prime ministers who come from all sorts of directions with all sorts of considerations, getting them all to agree to everything is an extraordinarily difficult thing to do. And as a result, many things, even some of the things they agree on, they go back, and their own pressures make it difficult for them to implement. So the system makes it very difficult to proceed. And I don't know how they can change that unless they review the structure of CARICOM. And perhaps that's what they have to do now, because we've spent a lot of time to go nowhere.
The discipline, humor, and grace that he encapsulated throughout his public life are ever present. He awakens every morning, just as he has done for decades, and walks briskly around the savannah, a testament to his discipline and devotion to his physical well-being. Known by many of the early morning regulars, he even has a spot unofficially earmarked for his car. Married for over 20 years to Marguerite Gordon, a Sunday Express columnist and writer, he has, by his own accounts, an extended family that includes 6 children, including a stepson, and 7 grandchildren.
The influence that my father's had on my life has been extremely significant. By now, everybody would have probably heard of his discipline. Dad is an extremely disciplined person, and he has always driven us in that regard. His whole life has been around sticking to things and making sure that when you start something, you finish it. And he used to get up with us at 5 o'clock in the morning to go and swim. So that he has played a significant role in terms of me being able to achieve everything that I have to this point. He always demanded that, you know, you do the right thing and you ensure that you succeed at what you do. Sometimes it was difficult to bear, but the end results were, I think, quite positive.
Surrounded at the family home by what could only be described as a collection of his life that includes family photos, sculptures, paintings, and a varied collection of books, Ken Gordon is the epitome of grace and chivalry, a perfect gentleman, but a mover and a shaker nevertheless. As we settle into the 21st century, still very much a young nation and region, where are we going? It is not an easy question. Perhaps with the native intelligence he possesses, his love for kin and country, and his sharp, incisive thinking, it is a question we could expect someone of Ken Gordon's caliber to explore.
Survival has become such a critical issue now. In very recent times where we've seen the prices of energy fall, Trinidad and Tobago has been carrying a fair share of the economic burden in the region. And once Trinidad and Tobago has been doing well, I think other people have, there's been a general understanding that their support mechanisms, the people will share, and that's worked well. But with Trinidad and Tobago's future now really requiring a complete rethink, which is what is required now, and the international environment, which over the last 3 years has been so uncertain, I think this has had a very negative effect on tourism. Tourism being the prime source of revenue and income for most of the other Caribbean islands. People are so primarily concerned about survival as a first call, but nobody's going to make a move now unless they can see that it's going to be beneficial or it's going to improve where they are. They certainly can't make a move that will cost them because they can't afford it. So that if CARICOM is to be the mechanism through which unity in the Caribbean is to be formed, some serious rethinking has to be done. And it has to be done on a very hard-headed basis. I think Trinidad and Tobago clearly has a key role in that. Jamaica, which one would have thought would also have a key role, has its own immense problems. And therefore, you can hardly look to Jamaica to do anything other than what will immediately benefit them. So it's a very complicated situation at the moment. And I hope that we will continue to have that vision of Caribbean unity. And however the cookie crumbles, we will be able to keep our sights there and, as it improves, go forward.
As Ken Gordon himself has written, which perhaps best summarizes his core values.
The impact of my mother's overwhelming honesty and her capacity for sharing helped me to understand at an early age that while frills are good to have and indeed desirable, they are not really necessary. It is people that matter.